Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Just like to thank you guys for the opportunity to present some of the problems that you could run into in a poultry house environment pertaining to the electric side, some of the issues that are fairly common and some of the issues that aren't very common at all. I simply titled my introduction into this, as far as my titles, Hazards of the House, the Where, the How, and the Who, and we're going to break each one of these subtitles down and go through them briefly. The where is simply something most of us here are probably going to be pretty familiar with, and that's our poultry house or poultry house that you might be called to work in or assist a neighbor in. And one of the areas that when I'm called in on a service call, I find myself, as I've gotten older, becoming more and more leery of electricity because I realize how dangerous, not just because of Bill, because of my profession as an electrician, how dangerous it is. One of the things I found that's very helpful to me is I'm driving to a site or on a call, as I start going through my mind some of the things that I want to have available to me when I get in there, such as when I walk in the house. What am I going to be looking for when I go in the house? Somebody might call and they say, my tunnel fan's not working, cross auger's not working. But there are other areas that I actually go through in my mind to prepare myself for the service call. The first area that usually that I want to take in when I open a door in a chicken house is the atmosphere. What I mean by the atmosphere is exactly what's happening in that chicken house. I want to feel the oxygen as I'm breathing. Do I have an issue with ammonia? Is the ammonia strong enough that it's going to bother me? If it is, I try and talk to the farmer to get a fan turned on, because you want to have full attention at the task and what you've been called for. If you're being irritated by breathing issues through ammonia and that, it's going to get to you. And even long periods of this, your eyes start watering. I mean, I'm sure most of you guys have experienced that. The second thing I always look for is the amount of dust that's in the chicken house. I'm not going in there like Mr. Good House Cleaning, seeing what you're doing and what you're not doing. What I'm doing is I'm looking for the effects on the equipment. And dust has a big effect on equipment. One way is it can build up on equipment. It can build up heat on motors and overheat motors and shut them down. The other thing is that dust can accumulate moisture. And I don't know if this has ever happened, if you ever changed a motor in a house that's covered in chicken dust caked in it, and the motor is moist due to moisture. When you get the motor free and you're carrying it, I've actually had them slip out of my hands. Fortunately, they always fall down in litter and they haven't fallen on my feet or hit my leg and torn my leg up or anything like that. But I try and make myself aware of those things. The third thing I want to know about is the moisture content that's in the chicken house. And not just humidity, but actually what's happening with the drinker lines and condensation. About a week and a half ago, I got called out one evening to go on a service call, and the guy's farm wasn't too far away from my house, about 15, 20 minutes. I got there, got the information I needed about what house it was. He says, I'm following you down there. We get down there, and I'm getting my booties on and all this stuff, and the guy's answering, and he's like, you know, come on, I got to get some feed running here. And he opens the door for me. He's like, my problem's over here, and he takes off across the chicken house, and he's over there, and the cross auger was a very old cross auger. It was belt driven, and he's got his hands up there, and he's trying to pull the belt, trying to all this. He's like, better hold up for a second. He's like, well, I want you to come over, and I need you to get working on this. I can get feed. What he didn't realize is when I walked in, I took just a few seconds to visually look at the inside of the chicken house. It was an older chicken house. I am familiar with the chicken house. But what I was looking for is what hazards do I know that are going to exist as soon as I walk into that door, to me, if I would come into contact with electricity. First thing I realized is entire litter was very wet in the house. It stuck to my boots, the plastic boots, when I was walking through it. Whereas the first thing I realized is I've got a damp location that I'm working in that's very conductive. That's the first thing I realized. I realized this guy had an enormous amount of dust on everything, which made it very hard as he's up there and he's pulling wires and everything. And I was trying to warn the guys, like, just leave things alone until I figure out what's going on. I don't want your hands on the equipment. And he's getting more and more aggressive with me about, you know, get in here and get the problem fixed. So I understand it, but I don't want you to become a part of the problem while I'm trying to locate what the problem is. Now, he fortunately had a bad breaker. He didn't have enough power out there to his equipment. But as I thought about this guy, and as I left that evening, and you know, I was rehearsing the things and the processes in my mind to try and grow my electrical abilities from the service call, and I realized this guy put himself in extreme danger for no reason at all. His help was there to help him figure out what his problem was. We were going to get to the bottom of it. But in his concern, he elevated his level of unconscious decision-making, things that could seriously injure this guy or possibly kill him. He's putting himself in a position with working with equipment that he says is not operating, which he did not know why it was not operating. If he would have had his hands around the belt and that motor would have started automatically, more than likely it would have pulled his hand right through a pulley. And if I wasn't there to help the guy, who knows how long he could have been. He could have lost a finger. He could have lost part of his hand. That's one of the aspects when I go in. I try to take in the atmosphere. Like I said, I'm not there to see what you are as a farmer. I'm there to see the atmosphere and the effects it could possibly have on me or you working on the equipment. I want to know about pneumonia because that's a breathing danger to me, and it's distracting my train of thought. If I've got to worry about this stuff agitating my brain, I want to know about the dust contest, and I want to know about the moisture. Okay, what is the moisture? Is the litter moist? Is there a lot of cake underneath the drinker line? These are all areas that I'll take in as I walk into a chicken house. The second thing under the atmospheric effects is, what does the equipment look like? When I walk over, and whether it's a feed line motor, a flex auger, a tunnel fan, a vent machine, I visually look at the machine. I don't touch it. I don't do anything. What I'm doing is I'm evaluating this machine or motor. If you look up here and you see the motor that's there, it's an old tunnel fan motor. That thing has been here a very long time, and you can tell by the looks. But when you're looking at the outside of this machine, what do you see? You see a lot of rust. You see a lot of corrosion. Okay? Now, what I want you to understand, in a chicken house, when you're dealing with moisture, dust, humidity, ammonia, what you see on the outside could also be on the inside of that motor, okay? Now, myself as an electrician, what that tells me is I could have a bad electrical connection, okay? And I don't know that because I haven't got to that point. And in the back of my mind, I've already established that I could have a bad electrical connection. And I want you to keep that point in your mind as we go through this presentation about why that's important to understand that. Okay? Now, look at the picture over there with the cord end. Okay? I'm not sure that you guys can see them clearly. But what you see here and here, here, and this spot here, those were connections when we pulled it out of a receptacle that the equipment was plugged into, where there was an actual arcing occurring between the receptacle and this cord. Okay? Now, I want you to understand what that means is, when you plug that thing in, if it's a new cord in and a new receptacle, those blades, when they go up into the receptacle, they make a continuous contact. There shouldn't be any, when you pull that out, if you want to check it and you look at it, you should not see any arcing marks where there's any bright metal. Okay, so what that's telling me is I know that I've got an issue of corrosion. I got an issue of corrosion I know on the cord ends, okay? The other issue with the cord end is what you see on that cord end more than likely is what's gonna be inside that receptacle because it's been exposed to the same level of what? The atmosphere. So if the cord ends are corroding, then that kind of tells you that the receptacle that they're plugged into more than likely has an issue of corrosion. Again, this in and of itself may not always be the problem, but as you go through the process of evaluation, you realize this could expose yourself to a real problem as you go through your troubleshooting techniques. The next thing that I always keep myself aware of, when I started working in the poultry industry about 21, 22 years ago, everything was controlled off thermostats and timers on stop signs. I'm sure if you guys have been in this industry long enough to know, you remember that stuff. You kind of had somewhat limited control when you were working right at your hands if somebody called you on a problem. You go out there and you could turn the thermostat up or down, or you could turn your timer off, and you knew at least that you would disconnect one leg of power feeding out to that receptacle. But today, when you work in a chicken house, if you're not following the proper safety procedures, you have to realize just because you put your hands on that piece of equipment doesn't mean that that equipment isn't going to start and run. If that computer is set up on a program and it's running through its program, and it sees this house is a little warm. It doesn't know that you've got your hands down inside a tunnel fan working on a fan motor, not to turn that motor on. If your flex auger's clogged up, jammed up, a feed line's jammed up, it does not know that you're working on that system. Okay? The next thing is the equipment itself is, some of it I've already covered, but basically on the equipment, I want you to realize is that equipment has its own problems, and it's your opportunity to learn about what problems it could have that you need to be aware of. And one of them I pointed out to you is make sure that you de-energize that equipment before you work on it, okay? The equipment's there to do a job, and when it's told to do the job, it's going to do its job if it's not broken. It doesn't know that you've got your hand up underneath the control pan trying to get a bolt that came in your feet or anything like that. It's just doing its job. So when you're exposing yourself to equipment, again, you're taking this in the context of the atmosphere. Look at the equipment, evaluate the equipment. See what it looks like, understand the potentials of it, okay? When you're looking at the equipment again, if you want to work on the equipment, make sure that it's de-energized. You unplug it. If it has a disconnect next to it, you turn the disconnect off. If you're not sure, go back to your electrical panel and turn the breaker off, okay? Next is the how of the hazard. And again, this is taken in the context of electrical hazard. What I want to do is give you a little background on the electrical side if you're a professional electrician. NFPA 70 is the National Electric Code, okay? NFPA 70E is the standard for electrical safety in the workplace. Now, what has happened is when I started being an electrician 25 years, a little bit more than that now, when I began my apprenticeship program, the only thing that they were worried about at that time was that you learned how to be an electrician. You need to know how to do your job. There wasn't really a thought given to safety. There wasn't really a thought, even though I was an electrician, there wasn't really even a thought about electrical theory and what it could do to you at that time. About 10 to 12 years ago, OSHA began to realize that there were some really major problems in the electrical industry and people who aren't related to the electrical industry when it comes to electricity. So they went and approached the NFPA, which is the National Fire Protection Association. They said, we need to set a standard for workplace safety, okay? Now, what they did when they established the standard, they changed the terminology of what a qualified worker was in the electrical field. Okay, when I first started, basically, the basic concept was electrician has to be trained to be able to complete his assigned task. In other words, if they tell you to go change a receptacle, you ought to be smart enough to go change a receptacle, okay? That's all that they were concerned about. The problem that they had is once they started doing the research and realized how many injuries and deaths were pertaining to electricity, OSHA got on the bandwagon and said, we got to put a stop to this. And this is one of the first areas that we're going to do. We're going to start training electricians to recognize the hazards for the job that they're going to have to do. So now they have not only told us we have to know how to complete the task we've been assigned to, now they tell us of equal weight, we now have to understand the hazard that that task represents to us or the people that are around. So why is that important? Okay, let's look at the number of injuries. Electrocution still ranks fourth in the causes of industrial fatalities. It's known that over 600 deaths a year occur to electrical causes. Now, I want you to understand the 600 deaths. Something I found out in my research, it's roughly about one electrician a day dies due to electrocution. Now, this is an electrician. This is somebody that's supposed to be trained in understanding how electrician works, okay? Since they have put the standards of electrical safety in place and they have started training us, every year electricians in most states are required to take about 5 to 10 hours continuing education. They begin to start training us on how to be safe, okay? What they found over the last 10 years is this number has begun to drop. But we're still in the ballpark of around 300 electricians die doing their job a year. These are people who are trained how to do their job. So that leaves us at least 300 people a year who aren't electricians who are dying from electrocution. That makes up the general public, okay? Now, most deaths occur in you being exposed to a voltage of under 600 volts. Roughly 3,600 disabling electrical injuries occur during a year. And basically what this disabling means is you're going to be out of commission for a very long time in rehab. You've incurred severe shock, probably internal bleeding, internal burning. You're down for a very long time. Okay? Another 4,000 injuries are reported because of electrical contact that are not disabled. Okay? One thing I found when I began to dig a little bit deeper into this 4,000, okay, these 4,000 people were hospitalized for less than 3 days. That means you could have got a shock and you went to your doctor and you had him run an EKG to where you had to be hospitalized for 3 days, for under 3 days. When you add up all these things that are going on and all these people that are going to be injured or dying, there's over 8,000 people a year that are affected, that are recorded. These are people that actually had to seek medical attention. This doesn't count the guy that's out here and he's working in his house. He pulls a receptacle or a switch out of his wall and he gets, oh, man, it got me. Doesn't count that group. These are the people that actually had to have medical attention. Next thing I want to talk about is the idea of the great misconception that because it's low voltage, I feel safer. I should be safer. It's not necessarily true, and I'm going to show you that here in a second, okay? I tried to find a statistic. One of the safety classes we took several years ago, they pointed out that at that point, more people were dying from being exposed to 120 volt, which is the household or poultry house voltage, than any other voltage out there right now. I couldn't find that statistic to show you what the numbers were on that. Tried to. Couldn't find it, okay? But I can't tell you how many people I've been talking to when you get called into farm where they've been working on a system. They're like, yeah, that thing shot me, but it doesn't really matter because it's only 120 volts. Nothing could be wrong more than that statement. Okay? I want you to be aware of that. 120 volts is a very lethal voltage. So is 240 volts. Okay? It's not the voltage that's going to hit you, but it's what it's supplying that's going to ring your bell. Okay? It's what we call, or it's what I define as the current thing. It's what's going through the equipment or the wire. Now, if you notice the picture that I have on here, does anybody know what that is? Nightlight, right? That nightlight's been in my son's bedroom when he's grown and married and he's left the house. But just an illustration, it's been in a long time, okay? My son was sick. We turned the nightlight on so we could get to check on him or if he needed to come get us or whatever. The bulb blew out. It's a spare bedroom now. Whenever we have guests or something, we turn it on for him. Bulb blew out a couple years ago. Okay, I went up to Lowe's, wherever, picked up a bulb, found a 6-watt bulb. I'm an electrician. Okay? I kind of geeky about that. I started thinking about it. I said, what's this really costing me to run if I'm running this thing every night for 2 or 3 nights? So I sat down and I did my voltage calculation on it. Okay, 6-watt bulb. Okay, comes to about 5 milliamps. I thought 5 milliamps. I know that term. I know that voltage. I know that current. And I thought about it. Look at this chart. Start at the bottom. You see where it says milliamps, and you see 1 milliamp, and it's basically, that's where you're the guy that you touch something, and you're like, I wonder what that was, and you touch it again, and it gets you, and you're like, oh, I know what that is now, okay? That's what we're talking about. Then you move up to 2, you get a mild shock. That's when it lets you know that I'm here, and you need to back away from it. You get up to 5 milliamps, GFCI will trip. Is anybody familiar with that terminology? GFCI, where do you see it? Your bathrooms, your kitchens, should be your outside receptacles, your garages, sheds, anywhere you could be exposed to where you could come into with electricity and water, okay? Why do you think it's set at 5? Look at our chart. It's going to prevent you from getting shocked. Now go up the list. This is what really surprised me when I was actually doing this. I never put this together in my head that I was actually asked to do this program, and I started doing some research for it. Okay, let's just move up here. Okay, we get up to about 10 milliamps. It says you can't let go. Have you ever heard anybody ever talk about where electricity has grabbed them and they couldn't let go. Have you ever heard that? That's where that, that's the area that they were in, about 10 million, okay? Double that up to 20. You start getting muscle contractions. That's where you can't let go because electricity's grabbed a hold of you. It's now done a number on your nervous system and it's contracted your nerves. You're froze to the system. It's just a matter of time at that point, okay? You go on up to 100 milliamps, your heart stops beating. 300, actually a little bit below, you start having breathing issues where you're actually probably going to stop breathing. At 900 milliamps, you're going to have severe internal or external burns. And at 1,000 milliamps or 1 amp, okay, I want you to pay attention to this. 1,000 milliamps or 1 amp, you're pretty much done, okay? What do you see that that 1 amp can do? A 100 watt light bulb. You know what a 100 watt light bulb is? In your house, unless you change to fluorescent or LEDs, you're usually going to have anywhere from a 40, 60, 75, or 100 watt light bulb. Okay? I want to put this into perspective for you. Okay? There's our GFI, and we're going to go through a circuit real quick. Okay? But I want you to think about that light bulb. Keep that in your head, okay? Here's how electricity works. Again, we're still in the idea of how you can be electrocuted. If you look up here, you see me up here, it says hot, okay? That's basically going to be a black wire that's being fed from a breaker in your electric field. It goes through your receptacle out to where this little dot is, okay? You've got Mr. Happy Homeowner, he plugs something into this receptacle. It completes the circuit, okay? Power goes out, goes through whatever it's running. It comes back, and it goes back through the receptacle, back to the neutral, which is probably going to be your, what should be your white wire that it's attached to, okay? What happens is as long as this thing is operating fine and there's no problems, this receptacle's happy, okay? What you see here, this little, I don't know what color, like a violet-colored ring around here, is what they call current transformer, okay? This is what separates the GFCI receptacle from a regular receptacle in your house, okay? It's watching what's going out and what's coming back. And if it sees anywhere between 4 and 6 milliamps of difference between what's going out and what's coming back, it shuts it off and it opens the switch inside the receptacle. Okay? Are you following my thought here? Okay? So now you understand, okay? You're a happy homeowner, you're in your kitchen. Let's say you're in there in the evening, the wife's doing dinner, and she realizes her phone's dead, and she plugs it in, sets it on the counter, okay? You guys get done, she says, okay, it's time to clean up. She walks over to the counter, and she starts getting some dishes together, stuff like that, starts filling up the sink, rinse stuff off, put it in the dishwasher. She accidentally bumps the phone and it falls into the sink full of water. Okay? What that GFI says, it instantly says, there's a problem. I'm turning you off. Okay? Therefore, your loving wife, spouse, significant other, she can live for another day. Okay? That's the importance of the GFI, and that's how the GFI works. Okay? Now, I want to look at one other circuit that's very familiar because I want to get you guys up to speed on how electricity works. This is a basic household circuit that you're going to find in your house, okay? You're going to have a switch located somewhere, and you're going to have a feed coming again from a breaker in your electrical panel. And it's going to feed one side of the switch. You turn the switch on, it's going to send power out, and it's going to, in this situation, it's going to turn this light on. Electricity is going to go through this light bulb, it's going to come back, and it's going to return again under neutral wire to the electric panel. Okay? Does everybody understand that? Okay? I want you to understand where electricity goes and what it's doing, because at the end of this thing, we're going to have a test, and if you don't pass the test, you don't get to eat lunch. It's that simple. Okay? All right. Here's a typical electrical panel that you guys will find, whether it's in your chicken house or it's your dwelling. But I just want to give you a little background in case none of you have ever had an opportunity to look inside an electrical panel. Up on the top, you're going to have a main breaker, okay? this main breaker, wires on the top of that are going to be fed from your meter socket, okay? Then it's going to come down and it's going to feed two metal bus bars behind these breakers. All these breakers here are individual circuits, and you see the colors of wires on there. You got your blacks and your reds. These are coming out of this panel, and they're going to feed whatever it is that they're attached to. Could be a lighting circuit, could be a receptacle circuit, could be HVAC, could be your well, but that's how that's happening. Now, if you look up in this area here, you see all these white wires and some green wires all tied together, okay? That's where the electricity is coming back to the circuit, okay? You following me? That makes sense to everybody? Electricity is going out off of these guys, and it's coming back on these guys, okay? So you've completed a circuit. Now, how is electricity getting to your house or your farm, okay? You basically can see over here that you're going to have some type of generating facility, and they're going to be creating electricity, and they're going to push it out to a substation. A substation is going to push it up to really high voltage, and then they're going to put it on these really tall power poles that are a lot taller than what you guys are used to around your farm or on the road. These guys are usually ones that are sitting out in the middle of a field, 150, 200 feet in the air. They're going to come down to a substation somewhere, and they're going to break the voltage down to a lower, basically a medium voltage around 7,200. Then it's going to come into your neighborhood, and it's going to go to this transformer. This transformer is going to break that power down to 120, 240 volts. And it's going to be attached through wiring into your meter side, usually underground or overhead. Okay. Now, if you have a problem in your building, whether it's your house or your chicken house, you remember what I said about the circuit. How does the circuit work? Electricity goes out and electricity comes back. If you have a problem in your house, what it has to do is, let's say that you have a ground fault. You plug the cord in somewhere, and let's say the drill motor's bad, okay? And what it's going to do is it's going to send a very high surge of current back to your electrical panel, back out to that transformer, and then it's going to come back in on one of the black wires. You go to that breaker, and it's going to trip that breaker. This happens instantaneously. Electricity is faster than light. But I don't know how they know that. That's what I've been told, okay? It travels really fast. So if you walk in your chicken house, and you've got a trip breaker, let's say summertime, you get an alarm, power alarm, and you go in your chicken house, and you have a breaker that's tripped, okay? Now, I'm not going to tell you that every time this is what's happening, because there are things that could trip your breaker, too. But I want you to understand the concept. If that breaker's tripped, something caused a surge, okay? And that surge is very high. That surge can be a minimum of 15 times the rated amperage of the device it's feeding. So if you got a tunnel fan motor, okay, and that tunnel fan motor is running 6.5 amps, that surge is a minimum of 15 times 6.5. It's up there. That's what's flowing through that breaker to trip it. Does that sound dangerous? It's very dangerous, okay? That's why when you go in there, you got a trip breaker, you might reset it. If it trips again, don't be the guy that just keeps sitting there and bop, bop, bop until you see a flame come out of the breaker because it's had enough on you, okay? Don't be that guy, okay? Because it can happen and it will. Equipment does fail, okay? The concept that I want to give you out of the idea of how is electricity always wants to go home, okay? And if there's nothing else you guys remember out of me today, I want you to understand electricity always wants to go home, and it doesn't care how it gets there. It's going to go the path of least resistance. If you walk out there on a piece of equipment, okay, that equipment's got a problem, and that breaker's not tripped, okay, you could be in for a real shock. No pun intended by that. And I don't really mean it, okay? A standard household breaker, which is what you're going to find in most chicken houses, okay? Because it says 20 amps, it doesn't mean that it's going to trip at 20 amps, okay? Under certain conditions, it may not trip at all. It needs a certain amount of fault current in order for that breaker to recognize that there's a problem. Okay? And if it doesn't reach that level, then if you go out there and work on that equipment without disconnecting it, you've exposed yourself to that level of fault current. Okay? Now you follow what I'm saying here, okay? If we went back to our chart, how much fault current can we take without becoming disabled? Very little. Our body loves to conduct electricity. The only problem is we're not set up to use our body to conduct current. Our nervous system, our heart, our brain, none of it likes it. And that's where the problems come in. So if you have a situation where you walk in your house, you're going through on your daily checking and all this, and I realize it's monotonous. Trust me, I know that. My job as an electrician is monotonous. And one thing I will be very honest with you guys is, I've actually had begun to retrain my brain as an electrician to remain safe, to put safety first in my life. I want to go home to my wife. No, I enjoy my wife. I enjoy my house. I don't know about you guys. I want to go home, okay? I don't want to be the guy, because I've made a mistake, it's going to cost me dear. If I ever gotten shot, I've got shot severely many times in my career. About a month ago, I got shocked. It wasn't very bad, but it was a very lethal voltage. It was on a planet sporting bolt. The cord, a large cord, about that big around. We've got these big cords that plug into equipment. And I'm sharing this for you because I want you to understand the dangers, okay? That day, it was pouring down rain. It was a large metal warehouse with a concrete floor. A lot of dust, a lot of dirt in this plant. Guys told me when I got there, they said, Tim, that machine's down. You need to figure out what's wrong with it. I said, okay. I said, is it unplugged? Are we de-energized? He said, yeah, we're unplugged. Okay. Went over there, looked at the equipment, figured out what the problem was, made the repairs, and I went over to the cord. Never even gave it a thought in my mind. I reached down on the cord, reached down to pick up the cord. Like I say, this cord end is about this big around. Okay. Put my hand on the cord, and that sucker grabbed a hold of me. Do you know that I was the only guy on that side of the plant? The only thing that saved me from not being seriously hurt at that point was that it was a small enough amount of current that I could actually pull my hand off of it. Okay? You don't know where electricity is going to be, because it's not like water in your chicken house. You walk in your chicken house, you got a flood, you know you got a problem. Okay? Electricity, you can't see it, you can't hear it, you can't feel it until it wants you to feel it, you can't smell it, but it's there. When you guys are working on this stuff, realize that it's a force to be reckoned with, okay? And there's some ideas we can look at, and this is where we're going to go to next, on how to protect yourself. The who, the topic of who, the who is you. First thing is, and this is where I'm referring you back to how I've begun my process of thinking as an electrician, as I'm working around equipment and farms, is number one, make a plan of action before your problem happens. In other words, if you have an issue in your chicken house, okay, that's common, feed problem, motor problems, fan problems, whatever it is, have a plan of action before you even get there. Know in your mind, when you walk in that door, okay, and you know, you get down there, you might not know a tunnel fan motor's bad. You know you have a temperature alarm, you might have a power alarm. But once you understand what that problem is, make sure that you have a plan of action in your mind, how you're going to proceed, okay? Next thing you need to do is make sure you know what you're going to do before you do it. If you walk down there in the wintertime, I see it all the time, feed line cords burn up from condensation. You guys familiar with that? How many of you would just walk up there with the water running down the cords and just try and unplug it so you can put a new in? Okay? I'll be honest with you. I have been on service calls, and I have seen people out there. They call us to come out and help them wire, put the cords back on the motors and that. They're sitting there pulling the fan blade off, and the cord was still plugged in. I've seen that one time. And when I mentioned to the farmer, I said, you do realize the cord's plugged in. You know what his response was to me? It doesn't matter. The motor's not working. Okay. So do you know why the motor's not working? I mean, I didn't say this to this, but this is what I'm thinking. Like, you've exposed yourself big time. There could be a bad winding spot on that motor and it can't start. You touch that motor and that motor will fire off. Well, if you've got your hands in there and you move that blade and she fires off, what's going to happen? Okay? It's not going to be a good day. It's going to be a really, really bad day. That motor's not going to shut off. So, you know, the computer automated system tells it to shut off. It doesn't know that you've just lost a hand or finger. Doesn't know that. Doesn't care. It's just told, I'm going to run. If you're in the way, sorry about that. Okay? Establish your checklist and follow. Okay, let's talk about making our checklist. What you'll do when you get in the house. What's your plan? What's broken? How do I check the problem out safely? Okay? Now, these checklists, you guys can do your own thing, or I can work with, you know, the ag guys in Delaware, Maryland, or wherever. Maybe we can come up with a brief list we can put online for you. What you need to do is you got to think about yourself. You got to think, when I go in this house and there's a problem, how am I going to fix this thing? And as I've shown you, you're now required, because technically, if you are working on electric stuff, you're supposed to be a trained person, okay? So you're accepting that responsibility that you're a trained person to repair that. And I'm not saying that you're not trained enough to put a receptacle in or change your motor. What I am saying is that now you have to understand the hazards that can be involved with that repair. That's what's going to get you home, okay? First thing I, when I get there is, like I said, and I went through this briefly, is I look and I don't touch. I evaluate what's here. Next thing is, I ask myself, what's the safest way to work on this piece of equipment? First thing I can tell you, without a doubt, okay, de-energize. Unplug it, go turn the breaker off, get the power off of the system before you touch it, okay? If you got to troubleshoot it, we'll deal with that a little bit later, okay? There's ways we can do that through meters and stuff like that, that we can help troubleshoot some stuff. But number one, get into the habit of de-energizing. Don't always assume that everything's perfect, because I can tell you, and I know that most of you have been in the chicken industry long enough to know, chickens love to tear stuff up. They pack, they pack, they pack, and they pack more. They tear up cords, they tear up connections, they tear up electrical stuff, everywhere they can get their little beaks going. They're hard on equipment. The atmosphere is hard on equipment. We get in this rope thing where, and I'll be honest with you, our farm, we've got guys that work on the farm, they're the same way. They get, oh, we got a bad motor. I'm like, okay, did you do this and do that? And they're like, no, why? Have we not talked about this before? We want you guys to go home tonight, you know, okay? You get into this rope thing of, I've always done it this way, and that's the way it needs to be. We've got to break through the threshold of this, and we've got to reprogram our brains and ask ourselves, we have to work safely. We have to provide for our family. How many of you guys made a big investment when you bought your farm? Honestly, how many? It's expensive, isn't it? Big. How many of you walked into an integrator and said, I'm building a farmer. Here's $1 million. I'm building a farm. Put your chicken house, get them started tomorrow. No. You probably sat down for quite some time and really weighed this decision out. Is that not correct? It's not something you take lightly. Here's what I'm going to say to you. You've got an investment that you've made the investment for whatever reason. It could be for your future. It could be to provide. It might be because you wanted some land. That's the best way to have the land, pay for the land. Okay. I don't know what that is. What I'm concerned about is I want you to be able to use that investment to its full benefits of what you, why you chose to make that investment. You've got to keep yourself self-safe. Here's an example. We've talked about the cross auger. Checklist. Before you go in, check to see what you're wearing. Okay, this goes back to the guy. When I went to service call at the beginning, I was telling you about with the auger, he just kept, you know, come over here, it's over here. I know where the auger is. What I'm doing is evaluating my environment, okay? I don't know what your chicken house is like, okay? But what I do know is there's hazards that are going to be involved inside this chicken house that I'm going to be exposed to, and I want to limit my exposures. So the first thing I want you to do is, when you walk in, okay, and I see this lot, and I'm not criticizing anybody, I realize if you've been on your feet all day, when you get home, you want to be comfortable. Do not wear flip-flops, sandals, or Crocs, okay? Do not. Don't even wear tennis shoes, okay? And I realize they're comfortable, okay? Not arguing with the fact on that. What I am going to argue the fact is, I want you to have a good pair of leather boots that are waterproof. Now, why do you think a waterproof pair of boots is important? We've already discussed it. What's the litter like? It's usually wet or damp when you have chickens at some stage in the game, okay? If you have a good pair of leather boots that has some type of insulating rubber sole or a man-made fiber that insulates, you can even get electrically rated. That there can help reduce, if you would come in to contact, it could eliminate or reduce you being shot, because it's isolating you from the environment that can, as it goes through you, it's not getting good contact to earth through the water, okay? Next thing, you see I got three pairs of gloves up here. They're all very popular right now. The only one I would recommend while you're in your troubleshooting stage is a new pair of heavy duty leather gloves, okay? And don't get the type out here where you got the holes, you've worn it for 3 years, you got holes in the fingers. Spend the money, get a good pair, okay? They will insulate you up to most things to protect you with your voltage and your current while you're checking things out. Don't go to the store and buy the $2 pair of rubber, whatever you want to call them, rubber coated gloves, okay? The other one is what you see in the synthetic gloves. They don't insulate as well as leather does, okay? When you're in your troubleshooting procedures and you're getting this thing go, put on a pair of leather gloves when you walk in the house. It can protect you. If you get in there and a motor's went to ground, and that ground either is corroded due to a bad cord connection, a bad receptacle, or there's not enough ground current to check that, trip the breaker, then you still have current on that equipment. Okay? The only thing that's going to isolate you from being shocked by that is if you have something to protect yourself. Okay? Again, it goes back to, if you're going to work on it, de-energize it. Okay? A checklist for yourself, okay? Tools. What kind of tools do you have available to yourself? I always use the little tick tracer. They've got some up here they're going to show you, I think, in one of the presentations. And I also have a couple different meters that I carry with me, okay? I've got to the point anymore that I now always check power twice, okay? I usually check it once with my tick tracer, and I usually check it with my meter, just to be on the safe side, okay? Wear your leather gloves when you're checking for your voltage, all the time without exception, okay? Again, this is something that I'm having to reprogram my mind. As an electrician, I've always been taught, go up there, check it, move on, go to the next step. I now have to remind myself, get your safety gear on, get your gloves on, make sure your boots are on, establish what the environment, the atmosphere is like. I go through this list constantly in my head, okay? If you do have to check something that is energized, whether you need to take a receptacle out, take a cord in and pull it apart, buy insulated tools. Okay, insulated tools are going to be something that has like a rubber handle, and it's going to have your shaft or your screwdriver, and it's going to be coated in some type of rubber or plastic. Okay, and what that is if you're using those tools to turn something and it is energized, again, you're isolating your potential of contact. And the next thing I want you to be aware of is if you do have to work on something in your chicken house, and I realize this may not always be the case, if you find yourself having a troubleshoot, get somebody to come down and help back you up if something should happen. I'm not saying that that person has to be the most knowledgeable. But let's say that you would trip over your feet on. Anybody done it? Am I the only person that's done it? I've done it numerous times, especially if chicken house is dark. And I fell, okay? Let's say that you're working on something in there and something happens. You forget to unplug the feed line and you got your hand in the auger and your finger gets caught. If you're by yourself, who's going to get you out of it? Nobody. Same thing with the flex auger. This is the truth. I have seen twice in my time called out for flex augers, cross augers, whatever you want to call them, working. And when I got there, the farmer had completely taken the thing apart and the cord was still plugged in. And neither one of those farmers had a clue when I mentioned, did he mind if I unplugged that, why I started working on it with him. Never even crossed his mind. He was just worried. I don't have any feed, and I got to get feed. And I got to get it running. And neither one of these guys in this situation, none of them got shot. Okay? And that's pretty much it. One other thing I wanted to add was if you do have to work on something in the house, tool-wise, If you have to use a ladder, do not invest in aluminum ladder in a chicken house. I know that that's the cheapest thing in the store. Invest in a fiberglass ladder. Okay, aluminum will conduct electricity. If you would accidentally come in contact while you're working, let's say changing a light socket, and the lights are on, and you would come in contact with electricity, it's going right through you, right through that ladder, right into the lid. Use a fiberglass ladder, it's going to stop when it's there, and hopefully it's not enough current to take it to you, okay? Now, does anybody, that's kind of the end of my presentation. Anybody got any questions?
He said the proper way of using a clamp-on meter to check the voltage.
But it's possible. Have you talked to Carol at all about trying to reach Tom?
Okay. You're asking about, okay, this is a clamp-on meter, correct? Is this what you're referring to? Are you using this part here to check it? Okay. This isn't going to show you voltage. This is going to show you current. It's going to show you current. So if the motor's running and you clamp this on the black wire or the white wire, it's going to show you how much current's flowing through there. If you want to check voltage, you've got to use the leads on the other end and then set it to the AC reading. And then you can plug these in. If you're checking your receptor, you can plug it in there and check that.
All right. How about just say number 12 Romax? You're trying to pinpoint which wire is feeding which fan. Just put the clamp on meter around the Romax.
It won't read correctly by putting it around. It's got to be around one conductor only. But what you could do is you could take this guy here and you could plug this up in there. And if you've got somebody with you, you could have them while you're looking at this, and it's going to be reading your 200 volts, 240 volts. And you could have them flip a breaker until that goes off.
Well, what I'm getting at, this is paid in the chicken house, away from the fans down here and away from the pump room here, trying to figure out which wire feeds what. You couldn't really depend on that clamp on meter.
No, this will not give you an accurate reading.
Well, you're not worrying about it. You're just worrying about if it's hot.
Yeah, it's not going to tell you that. If you put it around the whole piece of Romax, the whole jacket, it's not going to give you that information. If it does, it's not going to be reading correctly because it's only designed to read on one phase at a time. Okay? Okay?
There's another question. Yeah. What about rubber beads? Because I know with biosecurity, they charge them to purchase rubber beads. I know a lot of us do wear them, and I do wear them. I do have a pair of those shoes for each house, but a lot of times with my feet, that's the easier to do for me to put on my rubber beads.
Now, what kind of rubber boots are we referring to? You're talking about rubber.
Tim, can you repeat what she's saying?
Okay. We're talking about the rubber boots that could be worn inside a chicken house, and the question is, are they adequate enough? Okay. So what we're trying to establish is what kind of rubber boots that she wears.
I have two different kinds. I have a couple pair of muck boots, but they're usually just for outside or inside if once I'm sitting there. But I use the other probably not so good. Plastic rubber, I guess they're plastic rubber boots, like they sell it. It's more called for your chicken boots.
Okay. All right. The question is muck boots or plastic boots, thin plastic boots that you would slip over your shoes to work in a chicken? Is that what you're basically saying?
No, you don't slip them over.
Probably like a waterman's boot.
Like a waterman's boot?
Yeah. That's
okay. Okay.
Yeah. Now, do you have the overshoe? Are they good? They're rubber. Are they good enough too to go over your shoe?
Okay. The question is, are your rubber boots that you wear in a chicken house good enough to wear to protect yourself? I don't have an answer for that question because I don't know what the boots are rated for. I have a pair of muck boots and I love them in the wintertime when it's cold. I usually don't wear them to work. But I know my buck boots. When I bought them, I did look, and they do not have any electrical rating at all on them. So you could wear your muck boots during your daily routine, okay? But if you go in there and you have a problem and you know you've got to work on something, you may want to have something that has more protection before you go in there and get yourself involved in it, okay?
Okay. My two biggest issues are, and this is common, I walk in and the feed is either jammed up with the control pan, in which case you just have to shake the control pan to get it going, or at the other end, at the hopper, you know, you have to reach in there sometimes and hit the switch.
Yeah.
It's not convenient to go turn the breaker off every time that you want to touch either of those things. How do you protect yourself if you got a short somewhere and you're hot?
Okay, the question is, if you have a feed line problem in your chicken house where you might have a control pan that's jammed up, and the procedure that you should do, because it's not always convenient to leave and walk back and turn the breaker off, okay? I'll be honest with you, that is the situation. I mean, we get calls, feed lines not working, and it goes back in my mind now, to the retraining process and retooling my thought process, okay? You can put on a very good pair of leather gloves, okay? And try and, you know, shake that thing and see if you can get it freed up, okay? The only concern that I have with that is if you do have an electrical problem, okay? And I'm not saying every time you go in your chicken house and something's not working, it's an electrical problem. What I am telling you is you don't know if you have an electrical problem until you establish what that problem is, okay? And it almost sounds circular reasoning, but the very minimum that I would do is put my leather gloves on before I touched anything to limit my exposure. If that motor went bad and went to ground, okay? And you remember the picture of the cord ends that were up there? A lot of times what I see when you're on farms is when the chickens go out, the cords just get looped up, and somehow they always end up in the lift, feet, the motor, the cords, and you pick them up and you stick them in the receptacle. The problem is what's all over the cords?
Moisture.
Moisture, you got litter, whatever is on that cord ends up in that receptacle, okay? So if you have a fault, okay, let's say something in this motor goes bad and it goes to ground, okay? You follow my thought? Where does electricity always want to go? It wants to go home, okay? If this cord, and you'll see these, if this is broke off, okay, this is your ground cord, ground plug, pin, whatever you want to call it, okay? If this is broke off, and you got a problem with this motor, it can't go home. Where's it going? It's going right here. Okay, right to this frame of this motor. And what's hanging on the end of this motor that's running 200-300 foot long? A big metal tube. What's gonna be on that tube? What's on this motor frame? Because it's metal. Exactly, it's conducting electricity, okay? Another issue, if you keep taking these guys, okay, and you dump them in the litter, and you pick it up, and you plug it in, and you don't clean it off. You remember I showed you the two ends on here where they were arcing because they weren't making good contact? The other problem you got is this guy here is only there in case something goes to ground. You'll never know if this is going to conduct electricity until you need it. Okay? So if this guy keeps getting, it's got a little groove in the back. It's like U-shaped. You guys can come up here at the end of the program and look at this thing. This thing keeps getting filled up with chicken manure. Okay? It may not conduct enough fault current to trip the breaker. So if you walk in and your feed line is dry, do you know for a fact that your motor and your cord is good so that you can grab a hold of that cable or work on that control pan without proper safety gear? That's the question that you've got to ask yourself. That's the question that I have to ask myself as an electrician. I have to reprogram my mind. Not only do I have to fix the problem, but I also have to understand what that problem can do to me. It's not going to do me any good to get hurt. It's not going to do any good to get electrocuted. It's not going to fix your guy's problem. It's not going to fix your problem. Does it make sense to you?
It does. I'm just...
I realize it's an inconvenience. I really do.
Well, the quick thing that you had and I've never seen one of those before, but can you carry that with you and touch the motor and let it tell you anything?
It's going to tell you to some extent. Each one of these things on the side of them, they're going to tell you the voltage range. 90 to 1,000 volts is what this one is sense enough to pick up. Okay? So it's 90 to 1,000 volts. If it's under 90 volts, it's not going to pick it up. That's why I went, when I go out, I use two things with me. I keep this in my pouch, and I keep this in my pouch. I check it with this, and then I check it with this. Because 90 volts, if it's doing any type of current carrying issues going on with it, it doesn't take much to make it a really bad day. Remember, very little current. Doesn't matter the voltage, okay? It's the actual current that's going to cause the damage to you. Very little current, less than a household light bulb, can really take it to you. Okay? Anybody ask any questions? Everybody must be hungry because they want to answer.
I got a question.
Okay, we got one right back here, and I'll take yours.
I think most stuff happens because of a freak accident, I think. So, like, I want to go back to, like, your incident when you were in the plant and you grabbed that cord. What would you have done differently? Because the machine was unplugged, you just went to plug it back in and got shocked.
Okay. All right, we're referring back to when I got shocked by the cord in the plant, when I was talking about the cord was sitting on the concrete with the dust and everything, and what would I have done different? First thing is I broke one of my own rules about retooling my mind, okay? I'd worked on this equipment enough to know I knew it inside and out, okay? And I let my guard down. I have two sets of protective rubber gloves that have the big outer jack. One is for really heavy work. The other one is for much more lighter work, like if I've got to use my meters or small screwdrivers or whatever, okay? What I should have done, and like I said, I broke my own rule and I paid the price, it bit me, okay? I should have went back, got my insulated gloves, because I knew that the chances were that that thing was going to be energized. I just did not take the whole environment, the atmosphere, into account. I knew it was raining, I knew that the concrete was wet, I knew that the dirt was damp, I knew it all. I just, for that few seconds, I'm like, equipment's fixed, plug it in. I want to get these guys back online making money. I made a conscious decision. It nailed me. And again, like I said, this is a process that I am forcing myself. And it's very hard dealing with electricians like me that have been in the business for a long time to retool your mind. Because it is true. Old dogs are hard to teach new tricks to.
We'll take one more question.
Okay.
Okay, let's see if the motor is shorted out. You touch it with the pen, with the light come on that pen? The little pen you got.
This one here?
Yeah.
It's going to depend on how much voltage. You have to look at the sides. It'll rate the voltage that it's good for. This one here will rate from 90 volts to 1,000 volts of current. Okay? This will do 50 volts to 1,000 volts. Okay? If it's anything less than 50 volts and you have this, it's not going to tell you that there's voltage on. If it's under 90 volts, if you have this one, it's not going to tell you that there's voltage.
Yeah, let's see if you got 120 volts there. But
if, yeah, if you have 120 volts, either one of these are going to tell you you got voltage on the case.
Okay. What do you use to check under that?
The voltage
if it's under that.
Use the other meter. Yeah, yeah. The question is, what do I use to check as a follow-up to these guys if I don't get a reading? That's when I take this meter out here and I set it to the proper setting for AC, and then I'll go ahead and check it with that.
All right, let's give all Tim a hand. Tim, that was great. And you're going to stick around. You'll be here for lunch and stuff. Anybody has
I'd like to pass the test. It'd be great.
All right. That's right. Don't forget. That's right, Tim. You still have that test. I think it gives us all really a lot to think about. And to think about, you know, if something happens in the chicken house, we're always got to get feed to the chickens. We got to get that fan back on. And, you know, we've got to take that time and think a little bit. And I think we better all think about buying a tool belt, and we better put all these tools in this tool belt that we need in the chicken house, because we all know that we all get busy, and Okay, so let's call up our next speaker.